And I invite Shanta ji to release the report, A Future at Stake, and share her visions with us. Welcome and sincere thanks to you, Professor Shanta Sinha.
Thank you, Manisha. I must thank the National Coalition on the Education Emergency for asking me to release this report. I do it with a sense of full hope and responsibility. And I think if only these voices are heard, lives for children would be much, much better than what they went through during the lockdown. You know, these are very, very difficult times. And we have seen through several studies that have been made on what happened to children, that they lived lives of precarity, total vulnerability. This report consolidates all the studies and research that have been made. I believe that they must have spoken to several NGOs on the ground, policymakers, educationists, and others to come up with sturdy recommendations, which must be, in fact, internalized, absorbed, and put to action in a manner that we restore children their dignity, their freedom, and their rights. A lot of wrong, as Manisha said, has happened to children during COVID. In fact, I would say that all the gains that were made before the lockdown were just dumped, totally lost. If you look at, I will not quote statistics, but I must say that in the last decade, there have been tremendous gains that were made in terms of education of the marginalized, the weakest, the girls, the tribals, the Dalits, the Adivasis. Of course, it wasn't the best for them, but there was a trend in which the children were moving from one class to the other. And there was some element of seriousness about education system and how education system was going. There were so many girls who, in fact, aspired for more, you know, and you find that there were many girls who completed 8th grade, who completed 10th grade, who were looking for what to do after 10th. And there were new hopes, there were new aspirations, new dreams. In from that kind of a mood, you find during the lockdown, there has been a total collapse. This is what I think Manisha had so well shared with us. But I would like to just repeat again that it has been a very, very bad condition for children. Many, many children were out of school because of closure of schools. All of them wanted to be in schools. All of them wanted to be with their friends. All of them wanted their bus rides. All of them wanted to study. They wanted to dream big. They wanted to be with their teachers. But you find that overnight, they were all dumped into their own homes. And with passage of time, I find through the kind of, discussions I've had and contacts I've had with children, you would find that these children were forced into work. You find millions of children going into farm work, sometimes into their own farms, sometimes into farm work for others. They were on chili farms, they were on cotton farms, they were on plucking limes, they were plucking vegetables, you know, and sheer hard work from morning 5 to 12 in the afternoon and again in the evening, with blisters in their hands, blisters in their feet, and when they went home, there was nothing to eat. In fact, this was a total disaster because when there were schools, there was no meal program. Children had some food, some predictability that they could have their lunch, but this was not possible. When they went back home, there was hardly any food, and over a period of time, the quality of food in their house diminished totally. They had only some grains and perhaps some onion and some chili. There were no vegetables, there was no oil, there was no dal. The quality of food was zero, and totally, I think children, some of them were even starved. The older children had narrated to us how they had to eat only once in a day. I mean, this is something which didn't happen even in days of abject drought and poverty. You know, that kind of a situation, who was listening to them? Girls were abused, were pushed into marriage for whatever reason. I will not go into that. But I think their lives was also very bad. Since I mentioned for whatever reason, I would think reason is a total state complacency or lack of seriousness about the state into looking at what was happening to children. There's no discussion in the policy rules. There was no debate anywhere. Children were just not on the radar. Nobody, no policymaker was looking at the implications of not having noon meal, not having education, of schools being closed down, absolute total insensitivity to what was happening to children during this time. And I think I would put the blame, 99% of the blame on this, rather than talk about it being, yes, children were poor, there's poverty, and therefore this has happened. Let me tell you that children cannot bear the brunt of their poverty. It is for the state and the state's resources that has to sort of rescue them from poverty, give them all the best that can, and work out schemes. In fact, it need not even be centralized. It could have been decentralized. It could have been grandpas who could have taken responsibility for the children. They could have been greater trust with the NGOs around. And certainly children could have been taken care of. But who cared? Who looked at children? Who talked to them? Who found out what was happening to them? Nothing, nothing of that sort. It is much later. After some 15 months, we had studies coming up, we had articles, we had research. But until then, voices of children were not heard. We were totally blind to children and their predicament. So there was hunger, there was child labor, there was child marriage, there was sexual abuse, there was irritability, there was anxiety, there was trauma. There were, within the house, the tensions brewing up between family members. They had no soap to wash their hands. They didn't have enough clothes because they had to use the same clothes to work and then come back home. In fact, I must tell you that it was a horror situation for children, and there was no discussion or conversation about them anywhere at the policy circles. At least now, I think we are in a position where there is some noise about schools reopening. And this report will tell us that schools reopening does not mean schools reopen to pounce upon children and start getting them to learn the 3 hours or to continue from where they left 2 years ago. So much has happened in their lives. One has to be sensitive to that, to not take it from where they left 2 years ago, but to take it from where they are now and then build upon that to bring back self-esteem, to bring back confidence. And I think it is possible and doable. That is what this report says. It gives concrete steps on what has to be done, and what has to be done need not be done in a sequential manner. I have seen some reports which says that you do this first, then the second, then this third. No, leave it to the teachers and their autonomy. Leave it to, as Manisha said, each individual and her predicament, and maybe the sequences will change depending upon what the child is, where the child is. Perhaps one would have to focus much more on a child's health, mental health, even before one would come up to sort of putting them onto reading and writing. There are many, many things that have to be done as intervention. For each and every child, there has to be a plan. Every child has to be tracked. There is no need to do more research on where these children are. All their names are on the attendance register. We all know that 99% of children, there has been enrollment of 99% of children. This is what the government talks about when we talk about victory of education. That means 99% of children's names are already there in the attendance register with their addresses. All they have to do is find out where these children are and make individual plans for these children to get back to school. In addition, many children are facing huge problems trying to stick to the private schools. And we know what kind of situation and exploitation there is in many of these unaffordable local private schools. They are all thronging back to the government schools. Government schools are going to be full of children from government schools, full of children from private schools. Government has to be ready for doubling their resources to do what they can to get children back to normalcy. When I say doubling their resources, in fact, if they do not do so, the loss is going to be acute, irreparable. I mean, there was no that if one whole generation would be lost for the country, for the child, if there is an inaction of the state. The cost of state inaction is going to be tremendous on children. They're going to be, again, with lack of confidence, lack of self-esteem. They would not know what their path is for the present. They would not know what their path is for the future. And it's unimaginable what kind of trauma these children would go if they did not have the education they deserve. And we will have to work harder than before to bring back normalcy. It cannot be the same program. It cannot be the same service. It cannot be the same inputs. One will have to be more imaginative. And in fact, consult children, consult community, consult parents. As Manisha said, children do have a voice. They have an agency. So we will have to talk to them. And I'm sure there would be solutions that would come out of it. I will not get into the solutions because the report has made it so explicit, so clear, and I would like each one of you to go into what is there. And finally, I would say that I'm glad that this is happening. I always believe that when truth is told, it has to be told many times. It has to be told 100 times. It has to be told 1,000 times. And we must never get tired of saying the same thing again and again, because we have to keep telling the truth till it is heard. And so I request each one of you, I request those who are in the press to make headlines, to keep repeating the same story. Don't worry that you're getting repetitive. It has to get repetitive till such time that children's voices are heard and children become center stage of India's democracy. Otherwise, there is neither future for children nor there is future for India's democracy. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. And I do wish that we all join hands to see that the best happens for children.